Hey guys, it's Jen. Welcome back to my channel. I am so excited today because I decided to do this very last minute. I wanted to film a Q&A. I haven't done one in a little while. And I thought, you know what? I've never used that little Instagram thing where people can ask you questions. So I'll just try it and see what happens. And oh my word, y'all gave me a ton of questions. So I'm not sure how many of these I'll be able to get through. If I don't get to your question, just know that I still love that you participated. And this was so much fun to do today. And yeah, let's get started. All right, before I get to the questions, if you are not already subscribed, especially if you're someone watching this video, that means you're probably a little bit interested in kind of me and my life and what I do. I really need you to subscribe. It really means the world to me. Go ahead and do that. You don't have to, but it would mean the world to me. All right, so let me see if I can scroll down. These are all of your questions. So obviously, now I just posted this morning. By the way, if you're not following me on Instagram, that's where I do this kind of nonsense. So make sure you go over there. I'm Jen Lefforge, it's very easy. But the questions were really kind of thought-provoking and interesting. So I'm not going to give a lot of thought to which ones I chose. I'm just kind of choosing randomly because for the most part, they were very reasonable questions. So let's just dive right in. This first one is from Disney Mama 64, and she wants to know, how did you become Disney addicted? So I became Disney addicted as a very young child. I was born in Southern California. We went to Disneyland a lot when I was growing up. And my birthday is July 17th, which was also the opening date of Disneyland in 1955. I was not born in 1955. But as a result, we would always go to Disneyland on my birthday, and they were always having this birthday celebration for Disneyland and for me. So Disneyland and I are birthday twins. And I just loved the movies as a child. I was the youngest by 8 years, and I was on my own a lot, and I did not mind it. Still to this day, I like to be on my own a lot. And Disney records were my best companions, and I just fell in love with Disney characters, Disney music, Disney movies. And so, of course, when we moved to Texas, we started going to Disney World, and it's just always been a part of my life. My mom loved Disney. She went the first year that Disneyland opened, loved the movies growing up. My dad loved Disney. It's just, yeah, what can I tell you? It's just part of who we are. My sister-in-law used to work at Disney. We're just Disney people, so... I don't know if I'm addicted, except for, because I don't really, that's an awfully strong word, but I do like it an awful lot, and it does bring me a lot of joy. So, Daniel J. Round wants to know, any updates on your bathroom makeover? So if you've been watching on the Joyful Living channel, I've only done one video, but Daniel, I'm getting ready to film another one because I do have some exciting updates about that. So if you're not already subscribed to the Joyful Living channel and you want to follow along on that, we are getting ready to begin a complete gut of our master bathroom. I have the contractor out here last week, and I don't want to give any spoilers because I am planning to film that video next week once I have the final numbers. But yeah, it's exciting. It is moving along, albeit rather slowly. But those of you that have done it understand it does not work like it does on TV. On TV, I feel like, you know, those home makeover shows, everything's lined up, and it doesn't really work that way in real life. So it will be done, but it's a little slower than we had hoped. Let's see. Happy Travel Vlogs asks, I hear Disney was so busy January and February. Do you think it will stay like this? So January and February was incredibly busy. And no, I don't think it will stay like this. I think that we have kind of a perfect storm right now of good economic conditions. A lot of people got good bonuses last year. You have a lot of holidays that went on where schools were out, and then everyone wanted to come ride Rise of the Resistance. There was just a lot of things that contributed to that. I don't think this level of crowd is going to continue. There's a lot of people, believe it or not, that only go to Disney either once in their lifetime or maybe even once every 5 years. And a lot of them, I think, were waiting for Star Wars Galaxy's Edge to open. And so we did have a little bit of a consumer like glut where they wanted to go, didn't go. Galaxy's Edge opened, they got a good bonus, and they went. My opinion is come the summer, we are not going to see the same level of crowds. I could be wrong. That's just my opinion, especially with some things that are going on in the news right now, which we will not get into. So Tammy Skipper is asking about when is my next race? So I'm actually already signed up for the Star Wars Half Marathon. That is April. I think I leave on the 18th. It's that, whatever that weekend is. Just the half, which is awesome because you only have to get up at 2:30 one morning. I'll be running with my friend Sarah that I ran this last race with at Princess Half Marathon. And if you have not watched that first trip vlog yet, please make sure you go and do that. And yeah, I'm really excited. This is why I haven't done Princess the last few years, because we always do Star Wars and they're so close together. But I am really looking forward to Star Wars. And I think the crowds will be slightly less because it's the tail end of spring break season and Easter. So Touring Plans is rating it pretty well. So I'm excited and Sarah's excited and we're staying at Coronado Springs. So you guys know how much I love it there. So I'm really excited about that. Katie Thompson is asking, how much is Orlando transportation by Mike from Orlando Airport to the boardwalk area? Katie, definitely call them or email them. They will give you a quote really quickly. The last time I checked, now they do give me my rides for free at this point, hashtag gifted. So I don't actually know the answer to that. I wanna say it's around $145 round trip, and then you will wanna tip your driver. In my opinion, worth every single second because of the amount of time it saves. But that's about what it costs. And keep in mind, that's a luxury SUV. They do offer car seats and they do offer a booster seat. So no worries there. And somebody else had asked me, where do they pick you up and drop you off? They pick you up at baggage claim from your flight. And on the return trip, they will drop you off at curbside check-in for your airline. So it really is, you don't have to go to like to the Lyft and Uber area or anything like that. So it's very convenient. I will put the link to their website in the description box below. Let's see. Toddy B, hey Todd, wants to know if I have any more Europe trips planned. So Scott and I are hoping to do a big Europe trip sometime in the next year. It may even be as early as May. We're not 100% sure yet, but I am so itching to get back to Europe. I'm itching to get back to the UK a lot. I am missing London. I'm really dying to go to Dublin for the first time. You guys know my friend Karen is from there. I've been trying to plan that trip forever. I've just had a lot of scheduling conflicts. And a lot of trips, quite frankly. So really hoping, Todd, to have a trip announcement about something in Europe very soon. So definitely stay tuned for that. So this is a YouTube creator question I think is really interesting from Kelsey Hogan. Hey, Kelsey. She is one of my most enthusiastic and kindest supporters. Kelsey has asked, what has been the most challenging part of transitioning into a YouTube creator? I'm assuming you mean because I left my regular job and this is what I do now. I think the most challenging part has been the lack of coworkers. And I've talked about this before, but one of the things I always loved in my 25 years of regular full-time work in several different fields was my work family. And I have always taken that to heart. I have friends still to this day that I met through work. My work community has always meant the world to me, and I am lacking that now. And I do have my online YouTube friends, and obviously many of them have become in real life friends. You see them in my videos, and you know, these people really do mean the world to me, but I don't see them every day. I miss having a team to bounce things off of and just that kind of communal aspect. I am thinking about, Kelsey, doing some kind of network where other YouTube creators that do this for their job can maybe start doing Skype calls or something to run ideas by each other, because I know I'm not alone in that. It can feel very isolating because, you know, you come down in your basement and you talk to yourself. And it's some days it's hard. It's hard to stay motivated. And I just miss people. You know, my husband travels a lot. One of my kids still lives at home, but he's a full-time college student, so he's hardly ever here. I have my wonderful dogs, but I miss having people around me. So that would probably be the hardest thing about that transition. Katie S says, is there a goal for your YouTube channels you have always wanted to achieve? So I have so exceeded my own goals for myself that I really do need to set a new goal. I would love to see a combined subscriber rate between the two channels of 100,000. I realize that's bold. I realize that I'm only at 11,000 on this channel. I'm at almost 3,000 on the other channel. But 100,000 subscribers to me feel, I think it's good to have a big, hairy, audacious goal, right? That thing that you just can't even imagine could possibly happen. And I do want to put that out in the universe that I would like to get to 100,000 subscribers. My first goals were kind of to be able to have it replace my part-time job income, which it has done. Those of you who may or may not know, I'm kind of semi-retired. I don't want a full-time job at this time in my life, but my job as a YouTube creator is kind of a part-time, some days full-time job that has enabled me, and I have replaced my income that I used to make as a part-time job, and obviously I'm having way more fun. So that goal was my first really big goal, and I just had my two-year YouTube-iversary. I didn't really do anything to celebrate. I feel like maybe I should, but to be at 11,000 subscribers on this channel and 3,000 on the other at the two-year mark has been huge for me. I have learned so much, and I feel like I'm almost at the point. I mean, I never feel like I know enough to tell anybody what to do, but I feel like I'm almost at the point that, particularly for people that are just starting out, I could probably save you a lot of time and money by learning from some of the mistakes that I made. So if that's something that's interesting to you, please reach out to me and let me know. So yeah, that's the answer to that. Let's see. Christina asks, what is a popular Disney restaurant you don't like? I think I've been pretty clear about this. Maybe I haven't. I don't like Chef Mickey's. I don't like it even a little bit. It's sticky. It's loud. The noise reverberates. I don't know why we're twirling napkins that we're using to wipe food off of our faces and food is going everywhere. No. Just no. And by the way, I didn't even like it when my kids were little. So this is not like, oh, I'm an adult and I don't like Chef Mickey's. Chef Mickey's and I, no, 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 no. No on Chef Mickey's. Out. O-U-T. Do not like it. I don't feel like the food is good. The floor is sticky. I just no. Don't make me go to Chef Mickey's. I would pay you to not make me go to Chef Mickey's. That's how much I don't like it. All right, there you go. Oh, this is a good, this is another creator question. And this is from Crystal's Trelly. Advice for aspiring Disney-related content creators, too saturated or go for it anyway? Go for it anyway, because there is only one Crystal. So just like there's only one Jen, and it's always gonna be oversaturated. I will say that the Disney trip vlogs do seem to be overly saturated, and even when I post those, they don't get as many views. However, the Disney tips and tricks, the overall organization, the how to plan your trip, if you have a particular perspective, your story is your story and nobody else has that. So I would say try to find something that sets you apart from everybody else. In my case, I found that my Disney Vacation Club content was doing really well. So that kind of became my niche. But I would say do it, because you're not going to know unless you try. I would encourage it all day long and twice on Sundays. It is so much fun. It is so fulfilling. Is it oversaturated? Yes, of course it is, but it was oversaturated when I started too. So that does not mean that your content, if you follow the right steps and if you are really intentional about being consistent, using your tags, getting a tool like TubeBuddy, and I have an affiliate link for that I'll put down in the description box that will really help you and kind of give you some training wheels. I think if you're good at it, and again, you know, you won't know unless you try, there is still plenty of room for plenty of success in the Disney niche. So yes, do it. Do it. Just do it. Don't steal that from me, large shoe company. So I will answer one coronavirus question, because I was purposely trying to avoid that for the purposes of this video. I made a joke about it on Instagram that you can ask me about anything except for coronavirus. But the question is, will coronavirus affect your travel choices? Here is my answer. It will if the travel provider makes a decision that affects my travel choices. So for instance, we just had the Paris Marathon was canceled, the Tokyo Marathon was canceled, there's talk that the Tokyo Olympics may not happen. If it will affect my travel plans, if for instance, the Star Wars Half Marathon is canceled. Now the Paris Marathon being canceled was the government of France said that they were banning any gatherings of 5,000 or more people. Should it become more dangerous here than it is right this second, which it has every possibility of doing, they may do that. In which case, Run Disney Races would be canceled until this is over. So it will affect me if the travel providers make that decision. I don't plan on canceling anything due to coronavirus. However, My husband is an airline pilot. He is on airplanes all the time. We are prepared. Mostly I'm prepared for should he come down with it, right? I want to make sure if we got quarantined for some reason, that we have adequate groceries in the house, that I have wine, that I have chocolate. You know, the important things. I did order extra dog food, which I thought was funny, is like the one thing that I was like, we can't get it run out of dog food. Mostly because Max, our older dog, has a very sensitive stomach and he can only eat one kind of dog food. And I was like, if something's gonna run out in the world, it's gonna be that. And I really don't want a sick dog on top of everything else. So it's really not even affecting my thinking right now. And I do feel like this will pass. However, I do think we need to make good choices. Professors at my son's college are already releasing the entire semester's worth of PowerPoints in case the university has to close, so you know students can access that online. There's choices we can make to lessen the impact, but right now I am full steam ahead on all of my travel plans. So I'm taking a wait and see attitude on all of that. Oh, I love this question. This is from Allison. Are the DVC cruises worth splurging on? I'm a new DVC member. Yes, 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 and yes. Especially if you are a person who is kind of a nut for Disney history like I am, if you are a nerd, if you want to hear from people, I mean, it's different on every cruise, but like to hear from Tony Baxter and he's sitting, you know, 3 feet away from me, to meet Bill Farmer, the voice of Goofy, to meet Brett Ewan, the voice of Mickey Mouse, to hang out with Karen Dotrice, who played Jane in Mary Poppins. Okay, we didn't really hang out, but I did meet her, so that part was cool. The performances that we got, the gifts. If you haven't, go watch my haul video where I go over all the gifts we received as part of the member cruise. It was off the chain. They do charge a premium for these cruises. Before I went on one, I'm not sure I would have said it was worth it. Now, basically, if you can get on one, do it. Like, don't even hesitate. Sign up and do it. You will not be sorry. I've never known anyone that went on one of the member cruises, even if y'all know we had some really rocky seas and all of that. But it was still 100% worth it. Absolutely loved my Disney member cruise. And I hope to do one again someday. So yes, totally worth it. Let me say that again. Totally worth it. Oh, this is a really interesting one. How often do you get to see your kids and what do they think of your YouTube channel? And that is from Mrs. Bold. So y'all know all three of my boys are in college. They have been nothing but supportive of the YouTube channel. I do think my small amount of success has surprised them. I think they've been very surprised when people have come up to us in the parks. A few of their friends watch the channel. Hey guys. They don't watch the channel. None of them can stand to watch it, but that's totally normal with a parent. I like to think that that's normal. Maybe it's not. I don't know. How often do I get to see them? Well, my one son that's at school in Texas, not nearly enough. He's home for holidays. He and I are planning to go to California together in May, but it's a long trek and he's super busy with school. So he'll definitely be home for the summer. I miss him terribly. His twin is at Georgia State. So I get to see him on the weekends because I got him a job at my old employer, which I didn't get him a job. He might have used my name as a referral, but he works closer to our house than to the university. So he comes home on the weekends a lot. I don't get to see him a lot on the weekends because he's working, but you know, at least to have a meal or two, you know, I love it. And then my oldest, he made the decision to ask us to pay for graduate school and he would live at home, which was a pretty good trade-off because we pay for our kids' undergrad, but nothing beyond that. So he's living at home to save money. And I see him a lot more. In fact, we're going to go to lunch here in a little while. And I'm so glad that he's home because he really does keep me company and we get along really well. So that makes it really fun. So yeah, I get to see them as much as I can. And we do FaceTime and we talk, especially my son that's in Texas, we talk all the time. So I've seen them more than I think I thought. I think I thought, oh, they go to college and this empty nest thing is not the case for me, at least not yet. Like technically I'm an empty nester, but they're still here. And they're still very much part of our lives. And we're still very much like in community as a family. So I hope that that continues as they get older. So yeah, that was a very sweet question. This is from Rysel Para, and she wants to know, how many family vacations would your family go on a year when your kids were younger? Well, let's see. We have always made vacations a priority. Always. The whole time the boys were growing up, Scott and I both worked full-time. Scott traveled. I had a very demanding job. We felt like our family vacations were what really allowed us all to just unplug and spend so much great quality time together. So at least two a year, sometimes more. We would always try to make a trip that was like a beach vacation, and then we would always try to do a Disney trip, whether Disney World or Disneyland, and then a weekend here and there. I just kind of called it a tax. My husband wasn't always thrilled with how much money I spent on travel, but I was like, that's the tax that we have to pay because we're both working so much. And if we hadn't both been working and gone so much, maybe it wouldn't have been so important to me, but I have actually zero regrets about any money that we spent or time that we spent vacationing with our kids when they were growing up. Those trips and those memories, you know, there's just something very different when you're together 24 hours a day and you're not rushing to school and work, and the weekends just aren't enough. And yeah, I love that we traveled so much. And the best part of all that is because we traveled so much with our kids are now like world travelers. They have all been all over the world. They have traveled by themselves. They have traveled with friends. They have traveled with my husband and I, or just my husband, or just me, or whatever. My kids are, and again, you know, when your dad is an airline pilot, that's part of the deal. I know my dad was an airline pilot too. That level of comfort with being in places that aren't your home is something that takes some time to work into a kid. And it not only has made them great travelers, it's made them more well-rounded human beings because they have seen different people's lives and they've seen different perspectives. And we've taken them to Europe and we've taken them all of these great places. And it's really formed them into citizens of the world, not just citizens of our little suburb, right? I think that's so important. And if you can't afford to do that through travel, you can do that through education, through showing your kids, you know, videos of other parts of the world and how people live. It has been probably the most formational thing for all of us, all of the traveling and all of the vacationing that we have done over the years. So it not only has a long-term kind of sentimental and memory impact, I think it really does help your child's brain and it helps them see the world from a more empathetic place. And I think we can all agree that we could use a lot more of that. So on that note, I will let you guys go. Thank you to everybody that submitted questions. Again, if you're not already subscribed to the channel, please make sure you do so. Put any questions or comments you have down in the comment section below. Be good to each other and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.